Well, she is best known to soap fans as Silver Kane, Erica Kane's sister on All My Children. But Deborah Goodrich Royce is also an author. Her third novel, I think it's your third, right?
Yeah.
Her third novel is a psychological thriller, an identity thriller is another name for it. It's out and it's Reef Road. So thank you so much for talking with me today.
I am so happy to talk with you. And you are in my home state of Michigan. Is that right?
Yes. Yes. Oh, it's, we got rid of the snow. So we had like 24 inches and it's finally gone.
Really? Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
So
did you have that crazy like rain and then freezing on December 23rd?
Yeah. So there'd be a nice sheet of ice on top of it. It was fun. Yeah. Snow blowing, you know, it was, it was a whole different thing. So tell me a little bit, because I hadn't heard of identity thriller. So what is an identity thriller?
So I made it up. It's my term. So it's a kind of thriller that really digs into puzzles of identity. Who are people and what are the secrets they keep? So it's not a super violent thriller, but it is that peeling of the onion. Have you ever met a person who's a fraud? I did once, and it blew my mind when it came out. And, you know, stuff like that just stays with me, that people aren't always who they seem. And as a Michigan girl, I'm very literal as a Midwesterner.
Me too.
Face value. So it always surprises me.
And you know, reading about you, like you've lived this really interesting life. After the birth of your daughters, you picked up and moved to Paris. Like, it's not the traditional route.
No, but I was married to an American who was actually, his mom was from the Midwest, but she had raised her children in Paris. So for him, it was comfortable going back there. I had studied there. And in a weird way, it became the beginning of my writing career, because it's when I left acting and I started working for a film studio as a reader.
Miramax.
No, first it was Canada Cruz. It was a French film studio.
Oh, wow.
They were desperate for native English speakers because they were investing money in British and American films and wanted kind of, you know, the local perspective. So that was before Miramax.
Yeah. How do you think those experiences like prepared you? What do they call you? The queen of plot twists or something, right?
I do think those experiences prepare you. So I am a writer who really, you know, published in whatever stage of life you'd consider me in. I'm going to flatter myself and say middle age. But I've got a lot of life experience. I've seen a lot. I've done a lot. And, you know, it all makes its way into your book, because your book comes from you, essentially.
Yeah. Yeah. And your soap opera life, right? It's almost like all, it almost... Like what better plot twists than on soap operas?
Darn straight. You know, they all, I haven't used the amnesia storyline yet. That is the classic soap opera. But, you know, I like short chapters, and I always have people saying, thank you for your short chapters. I'm in bed at night and I just do one more and one more. That's a soap opera thing, because you really can have that cliffhanger. You know, in soaps, they always have like, da-na-na-na.
Yeah, right.
So my chapters always leave with that little bit of tease that takes you to the next.
Yeah. And Reef Road, I this is a personal book for you in bits and pieces. Yes.
Very much so. My real mother's best friend was murdered on December the 10th, 1948 in Pittsburgh. Mm. It's an unsolved crime. It had a huge effect on my mom in the course of her life. She's still alive and well. And it had an effect on me. I was aware that my mother felt overprotective and nervous at home. So when the pandemic shut us all down, wherever we were, I was in Florida. And I started the research process into the real murder. I thought, you know, this is the time. And out of it came this crazy fiction, which is about two women. One, this lonely, obsessive writer researching the murder of her mother's best friend. And the other, this sexy younger woman whose very handsome husband disappears on a plane out of Miami as the pandemic is locking everybody down with their two children in their face masks. He's seen on security cameras. Oh. Can't follow. So that's what I mean. You start to really dig into what one woman's life has to do with the other.
Yeah. How do the ideas, I'm always curious when I interview writers, how do the ideas start percolating? Like, how does it begin?
Well, I'll give you an example. The book I'm working on now, I got an email out of the blue from a guy I didn't remember. And the email was, do you remember me? And he had this thing and that thing and this other thing we did together. And I thought, no, I just don't. So I started thinking, well, what if you have a character with a flawed memory? And does the guy know that? Is he making it up? Is it true? We don't know. So that's kind of, it's just a little spark of something that gets me thinking.
I love that. My brain thinks that way. You know, I don't write, but it goes like, okay, and then what if this happened? And then what if this was, you know, Reef Road, it's one of those books that also really kind of highlights like the ripple effect, right? Good and bad. To every action, there's a sequence. You did that intentionally, yes?
Oh, yes. That is the theme of the book. I mean, you know, there's the plot and then there's the theme, what it's really about. Yeah. And it's about generational trauma and what I would call tangential trauma. You know, there are famous cases like Dominic Dunn, whose daughter was murdered. Yeah. And then he went on to become a reporter, really looking at murder trials. Or Michelle McNamara, she wrote that famous book, I'll Be Gone in the Dark, which became a series about the Golden State Killer. They are both people in whose lives someone else was murdered. They were not the victim of violence, but it had an effect on them, yeah, as it does. And I think scientifically, we're beginning to explore generational trauma. And it's a really intriguing concept, what we carry with us that perhaps isn't ours to carry.
Yeah, that's the thing, the residual effects that may not, you know, I mean, therapy kind of helps, but not everybody goes through any kind of therapy. It's just,
right,
you know, it's just buried inside. I love how you explore the characters, as you said, like peel, you know, kind of peel away the layers. What do you think that does for the reader?
I think it keeps the reader invested, and I think it keeps the reader watching and paying attention. I had an editor once say to me for my second book, Ruby Falls, she said, rewatch the movie The Sixth Sense.
Mm.
And when you watch it, you get to a point where the big twist comes, this huge revelation. You didn't see it coming. I didn't see it coming.
Yeah.
That moment, they do a series of flashbacks where you see the breadcrumb trail.
Yeah.
Where now you can put it all together. So I try to do that in my books. It was a fantastic note. When the twist comes, I hope you didn't see it coming, but I hope you're then able to say, oh yeah, that's what this was. That's what that was.
Yeah, it all fits together. Then it all makes sense. Your genre is thrillers. Did you choose it or did it choose you?
It chose me. It absolutely chose me. I love literary fiction. I do love thrillers. But, you know, if you talk about thriller movies, I'm more in the Hitchcock vein. That's the kind of thriller I like, not the ones that are really super violent. But I think it chose me because I do see things in that puzzle mindset, those locking pieces and taking them apart.
You know, you mentioned the pandemic a little earlier. What was it like for you as a writer? Because a writer needs to write. Was it a good thing because you're stuck at the house?
It was a very good thing, but I was in Florida with my husband and my daughter and son-in-law and 1-year-old granddaughter and 3 dogs.
Oh, now, let's wow.
Just set the stage. I am a tidy Midwestern girl, tidy. And nobody else in my family, least of all those 3 dogs, are tidy. So I had a romance with the Roomba. I got a Roomba because it was the only thing that was going to keep me writing.
Yeah.
Not going nuts over it. We had so much dog hair, it was like tumbling going through the house. So the Roomba kept me sane, but the pandemic was a fantastic time to write. I mean, but it was so heart-wrenching seeing what other people were going through.
Yeah.
The reason I used the pandemic as a setting for the book, I mean, it was like, in a way, wartime.
Yeah.
If you have a book set during the time of war, there are constraints put on the characters. They're sort of boxed in a way. There are things they can't do, which is interesting. So when the young woman, Linda Alonso's fabulous husband, disappears, she's unable to follow because of border closures.
Right.
Now it's interesting. She has a problem. So in that way, despite all the terrible sadness that went on, it worked well in the book.
I love it. Your brain is so interesting. I just, how it twists and turns like that. It's just fascinating. And I do think that those life experiences of just kind of stirring things up, they just, it just unlocks something. You know, I've kind of done that throughout my life as well. What was the best part? I've interviewed her. She's just a sweetheart. What is the best part when you worked opposite Susan Lucci? What is it? What was the very best thing that you remember, or word she said or something?
Learning from her. The best part of working with Susan Lucci was learning from her. She was always gracious, always grateful, always even-tempered and kind with people on the set. So she was a great role model.
Wow. And you know, I put it up that I was going to be talking to you on social media, and I had a couple questions. One was from Steve off of Facebook. He said, what's the difference between a plot twist and a reveal?
Excellent question, Steve. So a reveal would be something that happens more in what you would call a locked room mystery. Think of Agatha Christie.
Mm.
In a house, you know that somebody was murdered. Was it this guy, this guy, this guy, this guy? And it's revealed which of the people were murdered. That is a reveal. A twist. You're in the movie, you're in the film, and you come to a point where you think, holy cow, the thing I thought was going on is not even the thing that's going on at all. That's a twist. And I have, for my first three books, written twists.
Does it ever surprise you, like when you come up with a twist, like, oh my gosh, I can't even believe I came up with that?
It does. It really does. When you do the work, for all the writers out there, and you sit at that desk or table or wherever you sit every day, you do go into a little bit of a channeling mode. There's something that happens if you show up, the ideas show up and meet you. They do.
Yeah. Oh, so many New York Times bestseller authors have told me that same thing, where they've compared it to like something floating by. And if they don't grab it, it just floats by and somebody else grabs it.
Well, Elizabeth Gilbert wrote a book about that called Big Magic.
And what is it called?
Big Magic. She's the Eat, Pray, Love writer.
Oh,
and
wow.
She names it. And it's true. It happened in science. Look at the radio. You had Marconi. Yeah. You had Tesla. Same moment in time. That radio was meant to come to us. We were supposed to have it. Mm. And maybe more than one person grabs it. When I was reading at Merrimack's, there would be, like, I was there for the Jane Austen craze. And I ended up really pushing for the version that we did of Emma with Gwyneth Paltrow. And I was very proud of that film. Mm. But it was like this cultural zeitgeist. All of a sudden, every screenwriter's adapting Jane Austen. And eventually it's because you've seen other people do it, but there's sort of this weird moment where you don't even know anybody's doing it.
Yeah. I've had those where, like, you're almost onto a trend or something before it becomes a trend. And then it blows up and, like, you see it everywhere. It's the weirdest thing.
Well, and I once read, the definition of genius is not necessarily having an idea that no one else had. It's just getting it out there. And other people look at it and they think, I thought that. I felt that thing.
Yeah, I love it. I you know, before we go, I want to talk to you because you did such a beautiful thing for the Avon Theater in Stamford, Connecticut. Talk about what you did. You and your husband kind of did it together, right?
Yeah, so I was just coming off a very sad divorce, and I met the wonderful man I'm married to, and he knew I'd been in the film business and he'd been in the financial business. Mm-hmm. And he said, you know, there's this really cool 1939 cinema in Stamford. Let's buy it. Let's restore it. And for a minute I said, I don't really know anything about that end of the movie business. It's been one of the greatest things we've ever done. It's beautiful. We just had the book launch for Reef Road there. It's vibrant. And, you know, Main Street cinemas are economic generators for downtowns or small towns.
Yeah.
People need to gather. And watching a movie on a big screen is really different from all alone.
So true. And you know, community theater, local theater, there's something, a community needs that. Like, they need to have that, as because that's where everybody starts. Where are they going to start? You know, up and coming actors that kind of want to, you know, try it out. I mean, when you bring in people like Richard Gere, Chloe 70 to this restored theater. What's that like? I mean, it seems like there'd just be so much excitement and electricity.
Well, it's thrilling. Because we're 1 hour outside of New York, all we really have to get them is a driver, a car.
Yeah.
We don't have to fly them anywhere. And, you know, a lot of times people will do that to promote their films. Or, you know, if you have an author whose book has been made into a film, they will come. So it's very exciting.
Yeah. This is the book, Reef Road, a novel, Deborah Goodrich Royce. You can get it at your local bookstore. You can get it available online everywhere. And where can people reach out to you?
So I'm very active on Instagram, and I use Deborah Goodrich Royce Official, because there was this very sexy, buxom, younger brunette who was impersonating me. I don't know why she was, because she was... awfully good looking herself. Deborah Goodrich Royce Official on Instagram.
Oh, that's great.
My favorite place.
Oh, thank you so much for talking with me here today. I loved it.
Thank you. You're delightful.
Take care.
You too.